One of the great privileges that I have as your pastor is dedicating children to the Lord. And this morning, we're going to be blessed to be able to dedicate little Avery. So I'm going to go ahead and ask the family to bring Avery up. And as they come up, I'm going to read a scripture from Mark 10. They brought young children to him that he should touch them, and his disciples rebuked those that brought them. But when Jesus saw it, he was much displeased and said unto them, "Suffer the little children to come unto me, and forbid them not, for of such is the kingdom of God. Verily I say unto you, whosoever shall not receive the kingdom of God as a little child, he shall not enter therein." And he took them up in his arms, put his hands upon them, and blessed them. Amen. The act of dedicating a child is a beautiful testimony of God's work in a family. And Andrew, being a single dad, has his family up here to also represent the support that he's receiving from his family in the process of raising little Avery. And this is a godly practice. We know that Hannah dedicated Samuel to the Lord, brought him to the temple. We know that Jesus' parents, Mary and Joseph, also brought him to the temple and presented him at the temple and dedicated him to the Lord at the temple. So this is a godly process. This is a godly tradition. And I think it's very meaningful as we say, thank you, God, for the gift of life. Thank you for giving us this child. But also, it's an act of presenting ourselves to the Lord and saying that we're pledging to raise this child in a Christian environment, in a Christian home, and dedicating our lives to that purpose as well. So I want to ask Andrew a couple questions. In the sight of God and in the presence of these witnesses, do you solemnly promise to bring up this child in the fear of the Lord? Do you promise to endeavor to lead this child to accept Christ as personal Savior and Lord at an early age? Do you rededicate your home to the Lord as a place of Christian environment in which the spiritual nature of your child may grow and mature? Parkway family, I'm going to ask you a question. Are you willing to be the godly church family that surrounds this family in helping to raise this child? Would you answer, "I will"? Amen. I'm going to ask if I can hold little Avery for a minute. Isn't she beautiful? She is. I'm going to come over here because she's trying to look at Daddy. Would y'all stretch your hands and touch her? And let's pray the prayer of dedication. Stretch your hands, church, towards this family. Father, what an awesome privilege it is to dedicate this child to the Lord. We thank you for this child. Hallelujah. And we ask that you would put your hand upon this child. I plead the blood of Jesus over this child, and I ask that you would send your holy angels to stand guard and stand watch over this child all of her days and all of her ways. And I'm asking in the name of Jesus that you would protect her from all hurt or harm or danger in the name of Jesus. And Father, put your hand upon her. You've got wonderful plans for her. Hallelujah. And we're asking that you would bring those plans to fruition. And Father, we're also praying for her healing in Jesus' name, that you would heal her completely and totally of every infirmity that would try to grip her life. We're asking that the power of these infirmities would be broken in Jesus' name, and that you would raise her up in the name of Jesus with health and wholeness and healing in her body in the name of Jesus. And we also present this family to you, and we ask that you would put your hand on this family, put your hand on Andrew, and use him as a godly father, as a godly influence in the life of Avery. Let it be so, I pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. I've got a couple of gifts to give you guys. First is a white flower. This one's for Avery. And this represents the purity, the innocence of childhood. Now, we all know that from the beginning, there is sin in the life of every child. And if you don't believe that, just put two of them in the room with one toy, and you'll find out real quickly. But you also have to admit that the life of a child is somewhat of a blank slate that we have the honor and privilege of writing on and influencing in such a way to lead them to Christ. And so I'd like to present this to Avery, and as a reminder of the innocence of childhood and of our responsibility to speak life into her. And Andrew, I've got a red flower for you, because you the man, you are the one who stands in the gap for this child. You are the one who has authority over this child. You are the one who can claim this child for Christ and for his kingdom. You are the one who speaks destiny into this child's life. And this child is going to look to you as a godly example and is going to figure out their concept of men is going to be based on what you show this child. And so I want to encourage you to be the man of God, the man of prayer, the man of integrity, the godly example for Avery. And then we've got a certificate of dedication, and we've got baby's first Bible, because her life and all of our lives needs to be grounded on the Word of God. So this is a wonderful honor and privilege. Parkway, let's say how much we love this family. Let's give God praise for this family. Praise the Lord. Can we stand together? Wow. I don't know if anybody else needed that this morning, but I needed that. I needed that. Oh, thank you, God. Hallelujah. Thank you, God. Whew. Thank you, Lord. We've been doing a series called Shalom, God's Peace and Purpose. And in this series, we've been focusing on the Shalom of God and how that His desire is for His Shalom, His peace, His prosperity, His tranquility, His contentment to fill our lives. But today, in Holy Week, I feel led to go a little different direction. And we're going to focus on Jesus being our peace. Can we pray right now? Father, we thank you for the power of your word. We humble ourselves before you. We're asking that you would change and transform us by the living word of God. Speak to our hearts. And may every person in this room be right with you before this service is over. Let it be so, I pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Romans 5, verses 1 and 2 says, since we have been justified through faith, we have peace, we have shalom with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have gained access by faith into this grace in which we now stand. You see, we've been justified through faith. There's no other way that we can have peace with God the Father except through Jesus Christ the Son. There's no other way. You can't have peace with God through Buddha. You can't have peace with God through Muhammad. I know this is politically incorrect. You can't have peace with God through Confucius or any other way. We are Christians, and we believe that the only way that you can have peace with God the Father is through Jesus Christ the Son. Amen? That's the only way. John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him will not perish, but will have everlasting life. If you put your faith and your trust and your hope in Jesus, you can have peace with God. And the peace that passes all understanding can flood your heart, can flood your mind. You can have peace with God, but it's only if you put your faith in him. Ephesians 2, verses 8 and 9, it is by grace you have been saved through faith, and this not from yourselves, it is the gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast. There's not a single person in here who deserves the grace of God. There's not a single person in here who can earn the grace of God. We can't earn it. We don't deserve it. It is a free gift of God. Jesus Christ was given to us freely as the only begotten Son of the Father. He was given freely to us. And the only thing that we can do is accept and believe. It's a free gift. He's a free gift. But there's a little paradox involved. He's a free gift that will cost you everything. You know how Jesus talked in those kind of paradoxes, the last shall be first, and the first shall be last. Well, that's kind of how this free gift of Jesus has to be received in your life. The only way that Jesus can be the Lord, the Master, the King, the leader of your life is if you surrender and he actually becomes the leader, the Master, the King, the Lord of your life. There can't be two leaders leading. You can't be the leader and then Jesus also be the leader. It's either Jesus being the leader or you're being the leader. And when you're the leader, it's not Jesus. When Jesus is the leader, it's not you. And so you give up the ability to choose your own way when you choose Jesus' way. Jesus Christ is the only way that we can have peace, shalom, with God. Ephesians 2:14, for he himself is our peace. He himself is our peace. There's a lot of people who want peace, but they don't want Jesus. They want to have peace, and so they do transcendental meditation, or, I mean, you know, you name the different avenues and the ways that people seek peace. But you can't have peace without Jesus. There's no way. He himself is our peace, so you can't have real peace unless you have him. He is our peace. Now, Colossians chapter 1, verses 19 and 20 says, for God was pleased to have all his fullness dwell in him, in Christ, in Jesus, and through him to reconcile to himself all things. So how was this peace through Jesus accomplished? By making peace, by making shalom, by making peace through his blood shed on the cross. This was a costly peace. This peace costs Jesus his life. This peace cost Jesus the shedding of his own blood. This is a costly peace. This isn't some cheap peace that you can sign up for and then click unsubscribe whenever you want to. This is a peace that cost Jesus his life by making peace through his blood shed on the cross. Tomorrow night at sundown begins Passover. And Passover, as you all know, is the Jewish feast, the Jewish festival that commemorates when the Israelites were in Egypt. And it's a powerful story, and I won't take time to tell the story, except just to say that God was trying to liberate the Israelites from Egypt. And in order to do that, 10 plagues were released on the Egyptians. And they kept saying no. And the plagues kept getting worse and worse and worse. And so finally, the only plague that I guess God knew that would cause them to let God's people go was the losing of each firstborn child. But God made provision for the Israelites through the shedding of the blood of a perfect Passover lamb. And as that blood was shed and was taken and spread on the doorposts of each home of the Israelites, that blood served as a sign to the destroyer. And as the destroyer came through Egypt, when he saw that blood of the Passover lamb on the doorposts, that family was protected. And so the destroyer passed over them. And so now the Jewish people continue to celebrate the Passover. But now we know from 1 Corinthians 5, verse 7, for indeed Christ, our Passover, was sacrificed for us. Jesus Christ became that perfect Passover lamb. John the Baptist said, behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Jesus took the sin of the whole world upon himself. He took the punishment that you and I deserved. The wages of sin is death. And we earned that paycheck of death. All have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. We've all blown it. We've all messed up. If we're willing to admit it, we've all made a mess of things. But God's free gift to us. Hallelujah. Our God's free gift to us is His Son, Jesus Christ. And through the shedding of His blood on the cross, He became our Passover. And hallelujah, we don't have to face eternal condemnation, eternal damnation. We don't have to face that. Everyone who believes in Him will not perish, but will have everlasting life. Hallelujah. It's through the blood of Jesus. It's through the sacrifice of Jesus. It's through Christ, our Passover, that we have been given the victory over sin, the victory over death, the victory over hell, victory over the grave, victory over sickness, victory over disease. Hallelujah. He has given us the victory. He said, it is finished. It has been accomplished. It has been completed. It is finished. And that was the declaration of victory. Hallelujah. From the cross. Hallelujah. Isaiah chapter 53, verse 5 reminds us of the costliness of this peace. He was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was upon Him. And by His wounds, we are healed. Hallelujah. Can we just thank Him? Thank you, Lord. Thank you. Thank you, God. Well, Philip, I don't understand. What does all this have to do with Palm Sunday? Shouting Hosanna as Jesus comes into the city. Welcoming Him as King. Coming into Jerusalem. I'd like for you to turn over with me to Luke 19. Verse 37 and 38. This is Luke's version of Jesus' triumphal procession into the city. When He came near the place where the road goes down the Mount of Olives, those of us that have been to the Holy Land, we've seen that. As you come down the Mount of Olives and you go up to Jerusalem, you're able to see the whole Temple Mount, and you're able to see the place where the Lord put His name. When He came near the place where the road goes down the Mount of Olives, the whole crowd of disciples began joyfully to praise God in loud voices for all the miracles they had seen. Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest. Little did the disciples know that day that in order for there to be peace, peace in heaven and on earth, peace between God and man. Little did they know the cost of the peace. The cost of the peace, that it would take the very life of Jesus, the shedding of his blood. So as they cried out, "Peace in heaven," they didn't realize it, but they were calling for the death of Jesus. Because he himself is our peace. He is our Passover lamb. He is the only way that we can have peace with God. And so even though they were crying, "Peace in heaven," as an exclamation of praise, they were actually crying out for the blood of Jesus. So as they welcomed the Prince of Peace into Jerusalem that day, in Hebrew it's Sar Shalom, Prince of Peace. As they welcomed Sar Shalom into Jerusalem that day, little did they realize that they were calling for the death of the Prince of Peace, because there was no other way that peace could be in heaven and on earth, peace between God and man. You know, that's like us today. We all want peace, but we don't want someone or something that will remind us of our sin. Oh, I want God to intervene in my family situation. Oh, I want God to heal my sick body. Oh, I want God to provide for me to pay my bills. Oh, I want God, and the list goes on. We've got a list a mile long of everything that we want from God, but we forget the price. The price that it cost. It was the shedding of his blood. The shedding of the blood of the Sar Shalom. Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6. "For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace," Sar Shalom. "Of the increase of his government and peace, there will be no end. He will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice and righteousness from that time on and forever. The zeal of Yahweh Tzebaoth, the zeal of the Lord Almighty, will accomplish this." Everyone is crying out for Sar Shalom. And one day he will come again. He will come as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. "And the kingdoms of this earth shall become the kingdoms of our Lord and of his Christ, and he shall reign forever and ever." Sar Shalom, Prince of Peace. He'll rule and reign on this earth for 1,000 years, and then he'll usher in the new heaven and the new earth. And hallelujah, and he'll rule and reign from the new Jerusalem. Oh, thank God, one of these days, Sar Shalom will come and will establish peace in the earth. Hallelujah. But first, Sar Shalom had to lay down his life so that we could have peace with God. We've all sinned. We're all under the curse, first of all, because of Adam and Eve and the sins that they committed. We've all inherited sin. But if that weren't enough, we've all chosen sin. Has anybody in here not ever done anything wrong? I'm not going to ask for anybody to raise their hand because you'd be a liar. You and I both know we've all sinned against God. We've all sinned against one another. And we've all sinned against ourselves. We have sinned. And the cost of that sin, the cost of peace with God our Father, is the shed blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, but I'm thankful today that through His blood, we can have peace. Aren't you thankful today that through His blood, through the new covenant established in His blood, we can have peace with God the Father. Through the shedding of the blood of that perfect Passover lamb, hallelujah, we now have peace with God. Praise God. But I want to ask, are you assuming that you have peace with God? You never know when your time is going to come. We had a beautiful memorial service here yesterday for Miss Ruth Williams. What a blessed woman of God. She set a shining example for all of us to follow. But just a month before she passed away, none of us knew she was going to pass away. Oh, but she was older. She was 79. Yeah, but you and I have both been to funerals of people who have been much younger. It is appointed unto man once to die, and then the judgment. How you stand when you die determines your eternity. You can have peace with God. Oh, thank God. You can have peace with Him, but you've got to choose that before you have that last appointment with death. Because if you don't choose peace with God, if you don't accept that free gift, there's really only one other alternative. There are only two eternal destinations in the Word of God. There's the New Jerusalem, streets paved with gold, and then there's hell. That wasn't created for you and I. Hell was created for the devil and his angels. But if we reject the blood of Jesus, then there's only one other place where we can spend eternity. The blood of Jesus has given us access into the very Holy of Holies, into the temple of God, into the New Jerusalem. Hallelujah, into heaven, into the new heaven and the new earth. We can live forever if we accept the blood of Jesus. But if we don't, there's only one other eternal destination created for the devil and his angels. if right now, right now, right now was your last breath, which destination would be yours? I'm going to ask us to all stand. Please, every head bowed, every eye closed, no one moving around. Father, we're asking for your Holy Spirit to overwhelm each heart today with your love and mercy and grace, and open up our hearts and minds to understand the cost of having peace with you. That cost is the shedding of blood on the cross through Jesus Christ. Father, will you speak to each heart and each life in the quietness of this moment? Are they ready? Am I ready? Will you speak to us with the truth of your word and open our heart to surrender to Jesus and make him the King, the Lord, the Master, the leader of our lives today? Quietness of this moment. Is there anyone here today? No one looking around, please. Is there anyone here today that would say, I'm not sure if right now was my last breath? I'm not sure where my eternal destination would be. With no one looking around, would you just raise your hand if you just don't know exactly where your eternal destination? Thank you, thank you. You don't know where your eternal destination would be. You can put your hand back down. Is there anyone else? Is there anyone else that would say, I'm not sure? I'm not sure. Anyone else? Okay, I'm going to ask for everyone to look up. And look at the cross. And think about how costly. How costly our peace with God is. And I'm going to ask right now for individuals to be very brave. With everyone looking at the cross, I'm going to ask those that would like to surrender their lives to Jesus, either for the first time, or those that would like to surrender their lives to Jesus afresh and anew, as we're all looking at the cross right now, those that would like to surrender to Jesus, would you come forward and stand with me and allow us to have prayer with you before we leave this morning? can be brave. Don't worry about what someone else is thinking. Come on and stand in the front. No one's looking at you anyway. We're all looking at the cross. We're all looking at how costly this salvation was for each and every one of us. Is there someone else that would like to respond and surrender, either for the first time or surrender afresh and anew to Jesus? Thank you, Lord. I'm going to pause and wait just a little while longer. I know this is a little bit uncomfortable, but this isn't very uncomfortable compared to hell. I know that God doesn't want you or I to go to hell. He didn't create hell for us. He's given His Son, Jesus Christ. He's given the blood of His Son. He's desiring us to believe on Jesus, for God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in Him will not perish, but will have everlasting life. Is there anyone else? Praise the Lord. I'm going to ask if we can just all raise our hands as a sign of surrender to the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And will you just say with me, Lord, I surrender. Lord, I surrender. Lord, I surrender. Father, we just submit and yield our lives to You right now. And we're asking for You to take charge and take control of our hearts, our minds, our souls, our spirits, our bodies. Cleanse us afresh and anew by the blood of Jesus, by the power of Your Holy Spirit, by the washing of the water of Your Word. Fill us up with You as we open ourselves up to receive from You. We thank You for Your willingness to give Your only begotten Son. We thank You for the willingness of Christ to lay down His life and shed His blood. We thank You for that perfect Passover lamb that was slain, hallelujah, for our sins. We thank You for that provision of Your great salvation. And so right now we just receive. We receive from You, O God. We receive forgiveness. We receive the restoration of joy. We receive hope. We receive the faithfulness of God. We receive from You right now, God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You Yourself are our peace. And so we fix our eyes on Jesus, who the author and the finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before Him endured the cross, despising the shame. We fix our eyes on Jesus. We fix our eyes on our peace. Thank You. Thank You for accomplishing that peace through Your Son, Jesus Christ. Thank You. Hallelujah. And we give You all the glory and all the honor and all the praise right now in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Let's give Him all the glory, church. All the honor, all the praise. Thank You, Lord. Hallelujah. 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 Well,